They had a stability problem with it, so they actually took the dihedral and outboarded the engines. As you can see on the model, they actually put the wing back, slightly anhedral cranked on that. B-25, basically the first combat for the B-25 was in fact a Doolittle raid on April 18, 1942. Those were the B-25B or Bravo models. They were early batch of airplanes. They were heavily modified for that mission. The B-25 eventually served in just about every single theater of war in World War II, North Africa, China, Burma, India, South Pacific, certain parts of the European theater, Mediterranean. So it was a well-used airplane, and it was an honest airplane, had honest flying characteristics, and no real bad vices from what I've heard. I'm not a pilot, but all the guys I've heard that have flown it, it's just a real docile airplane to fly. Almost 10,000, I think 9,816 were built, and they were even used post-war by the U.S. Air Force as a twin-engine trainer and also a target tug, among other duties. VIP and transport aircraft, you know, for getting certain people shuttled across the country, things like that. A lot of private citizens purchased B-25s after the war, used them for their own personal aircraft or survey aircraft for oil companies, you know, business VIP transport, that kind of thing. So the airplane soldiered on. How many people here have seen the movie Catch-22? Yeah, 1969, I think Paramount was one, and it had just about anybody, everybody was in that movie. It had a great cast. But anyway, those B-25s, a lot of them were used in the movie. That was long before we had CGI, you know, computer-generated imagery. So that was all, they had a big fleet of B-25s for that movie. And of course, a lot of the camera ships for the air-to-air were also B-25s. So, yeah, great airplane. Like I said, you know, it built almost 10,000 of them, flew in just about every theater of war. And there's so many stories about the Mitchell. And we're going to hear a couple of them today. Our first guest speaker has over 20 years working with aviation museums, conducting historical research and educating air museum visitors. He has worked with the Museum of Flight in Seattle, Washington, and is currently the military aviation curator at the Flying Heritage Collection. He also has copies of his book for sale, and you'll find them after the show today. Please welcome Corey Graff.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. How are you doing today?
Good.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm going to broaden out the subject a little bit. My book is about Southern California's World War II aircraft, and we'll go through a little bit of it. This is the cover. You've got to start at the beginning, you know, start with the cover. I'm actually from Seattle, Washington, which right now is a little bit like the movie Waterworld. Except for there's more Priuses. So I'm proud to say I'm visiting Southern California, and I actually went outside yesterday. There's no punchline, that's just it. My co-author, my partner in crime, is Pat Devine. Unfortunately, he couldn't be here today. He's actually a Southern California resident, and unfortunately, he had to go to work today. Today is also, his school is in the final four, so I don't know, I'm looking at some suspicion about whether he's actually at work or not. This is one of the first pictures in the book, and it's kind of interesting from the point of view that every airplane in this picture was made in Southern California. We have the Burbank-made P-38 Lightning at the beginning, guy stepping onto the wing. In the background, Inglewood made North American P-51 Mustangs, and then we see the C-47 from Santa Monica in the background. So I thought, well, this is an appropriate way to start the book. And if there's a test after this lecture, this is the question. About 300,000 warplanes were made by the United States during World War II, and of those, about 27, I'm going to turn around so I make sure I get the numbers right, 27% were actually manufactured in Southern California, the Los Angeles Basin and San Diego as well. And if you consider the airplanes that were designed in Southern California and built elsewhere, a la Willow Run Factory in Michigan, or the ones in the Midwest, or Kansas City, where they were making B-25s, you get the staggering number of 41% of all warplanes used by the United States during World War II came from Southern California, this half a state. Now, there's some reasons for such a thing, and one of them will probably shock you right off the top. At the time, let's say 1935, Southern California was considered a place with cheap land. In fact, amazingly enough, out of the big four that we're going to talk about today, two of the big aircraft companies actually moved from the East Coast to Southern California for the cheap land and good flying weather all year round. That one I don't think anyone can argue with. Another couple of things that were happening right at the top, let's say in the 1920s and 30s, that were important is Southern California had the colleges and universities in place to get sort of the high-end jobs that you needed in metallurgy and engineering, et cetera, to make aviation a possibility. So these companies would draw upon these universities that were right on the cutting edge when it came to aviation technologies. The other thing that was going on is we see a big shift from places like the Midwest to the West Coast during the Great Depression. Lots of people came here for work. And if we think about California as a whole, many, many really notable projects actually took place during the Great Depression, during the Work Progress Administration era. And these, including the Golden Gate Bridge, the Griffith Observatory, the expansion of the Coliseum for the Olympics, Hoover Dam, or then called the Boulder Dam, of course not in California, but certainly affected the area. And then beyond that, we have all sorts of smaller projects that we don't mention, libraries, schools, electrical grids, water projects, etc. There was this huge burst of people coming into the area. So let's talk about our first group, which is Consolidated. Of course, they ended up being based in Southern California. Before they were in Southern California, they were in Buffalo, New York. And when you're testing an airplane, say a flying boat, which Consolidated became famous for, your two places to land were Lake Erie or the Niagara River, and you could get a situation like this quite easily. Obviously, there were times of the year that you had to cruise around the icebergs to be able to test fly your airplane. So, in 1937, Reuben Fleet, who was the head of Consolidated, who had actually been out to the San Diego area to learn how to fly, because a lot of teaching of flying happens in Southern California as well as Texas, etc., other places where the weather is wonderful. They loaded up about close to 150, I think it was 141 train cars and moved Consolidated from Buffalo, New York to San Diego. As we know, they settled at Lindbergh Field next to the Ryan Company down in San Diego. And this is a good picture of the very small building at the time and some of the flying boats that they're working on creating in order to entice the Navy into buying some of their aircraft. The first big purchase, and the one that's important for us for World War II, is the Catalina flying boat, the PBY. Now, they made the first versions in Buffalo, New York. This is actually a photo of some of the first California-built airplanes. So this is taking place within that factory. This is a 1936 picture, and these were actually sold to the Navy. The Catalina flying boat, half yacht and half airplane. I always think of this airplane as something that I would really love to have, just as sort of a mobile flying RV, so you could fly around and land and fish, lay in the sun, and then take off and go home. The airplane, of course, during World War II was used as a patrol aircraft, most notably sinking many German U-boats off the coast of, or the Atlantic coast, as well as a rescue airplane. It had many, many actually services during World War II. On the rescue side, many of the flyers in the Pacific that were shot down, including B-25 flyers, there's a great picture in the book, I don't have it here today, but in the volume of B-25 flyers sitting in the back of a Catalina, they're grinning from ear to ear because they've been plucked out of the water by this airplane. These airplanes, of course, operated in the Pacific and the Atlantic. They operated nearly everywhere. This is a good picture that illustrates sort of the unpleasantness of being in Kodiak, Alaska, and being in the Coast Guard at the time. And of course, they're working on beaching this airplane, getting it up on shore. It has wheels. You can see they're bounced out of the wheel well, and they're going to roll this airplane up. But it was quite painful work in some fashion. So the main event when it comes to Consolidated made about 10% of the airplanes built by the United States during World War II. And by far the biggest contributor to that number is the B-24 Liberator. This is a picture of the San Diego line. Interestingly enough, that airplane in the foreground is a Big Eagle. An airplane that was shot down by German fighters over Dunkirk. It was actually the first 8th Air Force B-24 lost in combat. So I thought, wow, that's a really cool picture to be able to see that airplane up close while it was still in the factory. So one thing I should say, and we'll come back to it, is Volte of Downey, California was consumed by Consolidated during World War II. They made their own products, the Vengeance and the Volte Vibrator trainer plane, but as well, particularly after they'd been taken over by Consolidated, people at Volte made parts and pieces of B-24s that they would send down to San Diego. We all see these pictures like this, of final assembly, and final assembly truly means final assembly. There's a lot of work that takes place before the airplane is brought in like this. For example, the P-38 factory in Burbank had 7 big satellite factories, and I don't know all the names, but it's like Tarzana and Sherman Oaks and all these various places that were around Burbank that were actually feeding pieces into the Burbank factory to get those glorious pictures of the P-38s being built. So, back to our story. The ladies on the right here are Volte workers working on a Consolidated B-24. It's interesting, they're rubbing out the only piece of glass on that nose. The rest of the nose is plexiglass or perspex. But the Norden bomb sight goes in front of that, or behind that piece of glass, and you wanted no warp and no skewing of the visuals, and so that's actually a piece of glass that they're working on. And then the guys on the other side, they're also working at Volte. They're basically building noses that are going to end up down at Consolidated. So one of the most famous B-24s is the Lady Be Good. This airplane was actually lost on a combat mission flying from North Africa into the southern Europe. And on the way back, they were returning. The crew was hopelessly lost, and they bailed out. And they thought they were bailing out over the Mediterranean. It turned out they were actually bailing out over the Libyan desert. The airplane was not found until 1958. An oil exploration unit actually stumbled across the wreck of this B-24. This was, of course, made in San Diego early on. Discovered in 1958, and then they started working backwards. It was a little bit of a mystery, and they started to try to locate the various crewmen. They'd actually all, none of them had made it out of the desert, unfortunately. They thought they were failing out over the Mediterranean. There they were with their raft in hand, and they ended up in the middle of the desert. And they discovered the bodies of most of the flyers, I think all but two, and the airplane was surprisingly intact, considering that all the flyers had bailed out of it. It was actually taken, at least pieces were taken by the Air Force and studied. You can go to the Air Force Museum in Dayton, Ohio, and see the engine of the Lady Be Good and some of the pieces of it there today. The main airplane lies in a Libyan museum, kind of in pieces, kind of in a scrapyard. So I come from Seattle. There's always this huge debate about the B-24 versus the B-17. What was the best airplane? And what I'll tell you from the top is the B-24 could carry more bombs, it could fly higher, and could fly faster. The only reason that the B-17 is in the running is it was an incredibly tough, tough airplane. B-24s were not so tough. One of the things that I've heard, an observation, maybe a reason for such a thing, is that the B-17, as well as the DC-3 type airplanes, I'm going to lump all those in together, DC-1, DC-2, DC-3, C-47, were designed at the time that metallurgy, all metal airplanes, was sort of a new thing. And the designers spent a lot of time hedging their bets, making the airplane extra strong in order to compensate for the fact that they didn't really know what was going to happen. By the time the B-24 came around, they were trying to get a little bit more, their tolerances were a little less, and it had this beautiful thin Davis airfoil wing and other light and sort of radical design features. And one of the things, one of the big complaints about the B-24 was that it wasn't as tough as some of the other heavy bombers. Here we see some pictures of airplanes breaking up in flight during bombing runs in combat. The book tells the story of each of these airplanes and what happened to the crew, how many of them made it out. So I'm going to switch gears here on you. We're going to go to Douglas in Santa Monica. Douglas is responsible for less of the airplanes built than Consolidated. They had more employees, interestingly enough. They made 10.3% of the airplanes. Interestingly enough, Douglas has the title of making the most pounds of airplanes, though. They made a lot of attack bombers, these cargo airplanes, as well as the SPD and TBD carrier planes. But a lot of the airplanes they were making were pretty big, complex airplanes. So when it comes to aircraft poundage, Santa Monica and the Douglas Corporation are the big winners. These are B-18s. This is maybe our sort of entrance into the World War II era. These weren't super successful airplanes. In fact, for the most part, they were utility airplanes by the time World War II started. But they're made from that DC-2 wing setup with a different fuselage for the bombers. And these B-18s actually come back in our story a little bit later on during our North American conversation. This is a really cool picture. This is the B-19, the XB-19. It took off from Cloverfield in Santa Monica. It's on its way to Riverside, you say. Well, it's going the wrong direction. But I think they flew it out over the water. Of course, I was really fascinated with this photo, too. You guys being down here, you probably sort of know this history, and you see this. All of those oil derricks down in the Venice area and the piers. Of course, this is a test flight. This is the first flight, and so the landing gear stays down on this airplane until they get to Marsh Field and they land. This is another airplane that isn't super significant when it comes to World War II, other than the fact that the Army Air Forces was sort of pushing Douglas into making this airplane, and the knowledge gained helped them and other U.S. companies build some really large airplanes that are actually used during World War II. So the big workhorse for Douglas is the C-47, which is essentially a modified passenger plane, a DC-3. I was telling someone, you could make a whole book out of photographs of them pushing various things into DC-3s and C-47s during World War II. You have a Jeep on this page, and fish oil in barrels on this page, and a donkey over here, and some engines, and another airplane going inside this airplane. They were used everywhere, and they were used for everything. Of course, we've got this picture of the C-47 over the Pyramid of Giza, as well as a photograph of the production line. Another thing that's interesting to note is the DC-3 almost doesn't exist during World War II. II. And what I mean by that is a lot of the airplanes that were being used by passenger companies were drafted into service. And I thought, oh, this is a really, really cool picture. Because you can see in this C-47 on the right side is actually just a painted over DC-3. You can actually see it says Delta Airlines on the door of this Army airplane. They had just consumed it. As well as, interestingly enough, the airline crew, the guys loading the airplane, the pilots, had been drafted into military service. And the other thing I love about this picture is the flight attendants or the stewardesses standing in the background sort of watching this all go on from an actual passenger plane. So another thing Douglas was famous for was making attack bombers. These are A-20s on the floor at the facility in Santa Monica. And I like this picture because there's a lady working on the airplane, and there's also, if you look really closely, a smiley face scribed into the dust on the top of the canopy of the airplane. It's very hard to see in this picture. As we'll talk about workforce a little bit, World War II brought a time where the men of the age to be drafted were off fighting the war for the most part. And aircraft companies in California and elsewhere had to look at other sources of people to use. And sometimes this meant young men that were too young to be drafted, older men, as well as women. And they started to actually turn towards other groups that they, African American, Asian, that they had sort of ignored beforehand. Douglas was another winner in this point. At one point during the war, 60% of the manufacturing corps at Douglas was women. And here's another good picture. These are A-20 noses. Again, we've got the sub-assemblies happening before the final assembly. And this is a fairly famous picture. I think it appeared in Life magazine of these noses in that big giant factory. So another thing that Douglas worked on was naval airplanes. And these are, of course, relatively smaller. They're made to be able to fit onto an aircraft carrier. It's maybe a story of huge success and also failure. We'll start with the failure. The TBD torpedo plane was built by Douglas. It was actually a Northrop design early on and then taken over by Douglas. And to its credit, it was an old airplane by the time World War II started and didn't perform very well. This is a picture from the 1930s. This is a mock-up of one of the first TBD Devastator airplanes. Of course, before they would build the airplane in real life, essentially they would make it out of wood and paper, let the Navy see it and see what they thought. The big success story takes place over about 6 minutes during the Battle of Midway in 1942. The Douglas SBD, which is the dive bomber airplane that they had designed, sinks three Japanese carriers and sort of changes the outlook of the war in a really significant way. Another aircraft carrier was sunk later that day, so four Japanese carriers were sunk on that day, mostly by SBD airplanes. So this Douglas airplane from California changes the outlook of the war. This is a picture of airplanes hounding a Japanese cruiser. You can see the smoke column down below. Okay, so we're switching to Burbank and Lockheed. This is a cool picture because this is taking place, this is an outdoor assembly line, and this wasn't necessarily by choice. This was June of 1943, and they were automating the factory. What they were doing is putting in essentially what amounts to conveyor belts for airplanes. So airplanes would start their final assembly, and about 16 days later, they would come to the end and be done. But to do that, they needed the airplanes out of the factory, and there was a war going on, so they picked June of 43 to have an outdoor assembly line. So this is kind of a cool picture of them building airplanes outside. The P-38, of course, went through all theaters of war. This is a photograph that I obtained at the archives, the National Archives, the California branch here in Riverside. And this is an airplane that's wrapped in a material called plastifane to keep it from corroding, and loaded onto an airplane that's headed to the Pacific. It looks like a modern art sculpture in a lot of ways. So this, the airplanes were used everywhere. In Europe, they were used as escort aircraft. They had a range that was longer than a lot of the smaller single-engine airplanes. The P-38 had a nasty habit. The Allison engines sometimes died, and they violently died. And God help you if you're taking off when that happens. But this one, you can see, went bad on a flight to Germany, and the escort has become the escort. He's moving in close to these B-17s in order to be protected on his way home. You can see that Allison has spit oil all over the back end of the airplane and all over the cowling. Interestingly enough, this B-17, designed by Boeing in Seattle, was built at the Douglas factory. We'll talk a little bit about that a little later. Another thing that I can't get over about the P-38 is this X-inch pod. They experimented with the idea that they could use a fighter plane to quickly transport an injured person out of the battlefield area. So what we've got here is a drop tank, essentially, with a glass nose, and you were able to fly people around in this thing. Of course, you had no parachute. You were attached to the airplane no matter what. A Life magazine photographer, a brave Marine, decided to fly in the airplane and take some photos. Those great photos you see of the Corsairs launching their rockets over Okinawa, really close aerials, were actually taken from a P-38 and some poor sap in this pod. This is him in Information Please over Okinawa, and you can see he's got quite an escort of Corsairs. Part of the reason they're there is he has no way out. If the P-38 gets into trouble, he's in trouble. The P-38s that were used as reconnaissance airplanes were called F-5s, which is super confusing, so we'll just not say anything more about that. So the Boeing B-17 was, of course, designed in Seattle, and the factory there, Boeing Field, made tons of these airplanes, but they didn't make all the B-17s. In fact, Lockheed and Douglas made airplanes too. And this is at Long Beach is a very cleverly orchestrated picture of the 10,000th B-17, which was built in Seattle, and the 999th, which was made at Lockheed, and the 10,001st, which was made at Douglas. And this is them all together for a photo op near the end of the war, which is very cool. So there's this interesting dynamic, this sort of sharing. I'm sort of sidebarring here. Let's see how I'm doing on time. I'm doing okay? Okay. That these companies would compete quite tooth and nail, but then they would also share information, and they would cooperate quite interestingly. We have situations where, say, the big hydraulic press of Consolidated goes down, dies, and they can't make B-24 parts. And so we've got guys in trucks that are driving up to Northrop to use their press in the middle of the night to keep these airplanes going. Got a situation where the P-38s don't have enough aluminum tubing to be released to the Army. So North America shares aluminum tubing with Lockheed. At the same time, they fought tooth and nail. There's stories. There's one story in the book about people, company reps, waiting at the train station or the bus station. If you come off the bus and you're from Missouri or Nebraska, they're right there to hustle you into a job before North American or Douglas or Consolidated can get a hold of you. So there was competition going on as well. And what I'm getting at is airplanes were made by whoever had the capability. In this case, Douglas and Lockheed. Lockheed are making a Boeing design. In the case of the A-20, Douglas couldn't keep up with the amount they needed, and so they kicked some of the progress or the project over to Boeing, and A-20s were made in Seattle. They were called DB-7s at the time because they were actually destined to go to France. And then when France got consumed by the Nazis, the British took them over. But so what we'll see is this situation where not every airplane that was designed by the company is actually made by the company. Speaking of, Fort Howard Hughes had to wait for this beautiful airliner. It was designed by Lockheed during the war and became the C-69, essentially a cargo plane. This picture was taken as a photo op in TWA livery before this airplane was painted green and became a C-69. This is a cool picture, just seeing the DC-3, sort of the pre-war passenger plane and what was going to become the post-war passenger plane. At the end of the war, Lockheed developed the P-80, which will later become the F-80. This airplane actually was kicked into the Pacific and into Italy. None of these airplanes actually flew in combat, but they were very close. Of course, Germany was making their ME-262 at the time, and we needed the jet plane. And so the P-80 is the first operational jet aircraft that was used by the Army Air Force. This is a picture a little bit later on after the war in Germany, I believe. Okay, let's kick our way back to North American. North American is another one of these rich companies that came into town for the cheap land, and they had big projects underway with companies in Europe at the beginning, even before World War II started for the U.S. And so they were making airplanes. Of course, there's the big three. One of them being a training airplane, the AT-6, the Harbor, the SNJ. Depends on who you are, what you call this, but this, I'll just call it the Texan. The training airplane, this is an airfield Randolph down in Texas. Students are learning how to fly. Pretty much every combat aviator flew this airplane at one time or another, right before they stepped into sort of the big, scary, fire-breathing fighter airplane or bomber that they were going to fly. And it was definitely a complex airplane, and you could do things wrong, and that's what you're supposed to do when you're a student. This is a picture in Missouri of a student who's bronked on the brakes a little bit too hard and flipped his Texan. I'm gonna work through these quick. I know other people are gonna. Okay. Oh, excellent. That's good. The other big airplane that was made by North American Aviation is this NA-73 we see on the right. This is a fighter airplane, and it's the first fighter airplane ever made by North American, which is sort of crazy. The way this started was the British wanted North American to make license-built P-40s. P-40s, at the time, was not a stellar, beautiful, awesome airplane. And North American did something that was kind of gutsy. They said, we're going to make you a better airplane in the time it would take to gear up and make P-40s. And somehow the British said, okay, we'll see how that goes. And what resulted was a brilliant design, and actually a relatively simple design, this NA-73, which becomes the P-51 Mustang. The picture on the right of the airplane has an Allison engine, and that was actually one of the last stumbling blocks to this being a really super airplane. When they changed it out for a Rolls-Royce Merlin, we have a real winner. The airplanes on the left have Rolls-Royce Merlins. One of the things that's interesting to illustrate in this picture is how the North American line was building various versions of the airplane with slight and subtle differences to improve it along the way. There was no way the government was going to let them stop the line, redesign, make something that was completely different. And so we see slight changes. The airplane at the bottom of this picture is a B/C type of airplane. They were making them in Dallas as Cs, but this is a P-51B. And you'll notice the canopy. It's got a razorback It's got this high back, similar to the prototype, and this was something that the aviators complained about quite a bit. Of course, if you're going to get shot down by another fighter, they sneak in from the back, and your vision out the back of the airplane is quite diminished. Now, the next thing we have is the middle airplane, a D model, that has a bubble canopy. This is excellent. You're able to see out the back. Now, all along, and exacerbated by eliminating that razor back, the P-51 had some stability issues that were kind of strange, particularly if the fuselage tank was full of gas. And so we see a slight modification to try to alleviate that problem. You'll notice that the top airplane has a fin fillet in front of the vertical fin in order to increase the stability. The middle one doesn't have it yet, and the V doesn't have it yet. So this is kind of a cool example of you know, like the evolution. The little fish becomes the little creature that comes out of the water, eventually becomes a man. This is sort of the evolution of these airplanes. This is a very cool picture, too. As I was talking about, a lot of California airplanes were built elsewhere, such as Dallas. This P-51 was built in Dallas. And this is a picture of what is technically an F-51 at the time in Korea. And it's called the Old Mad SOV. So it's the old napalm dropping, and I'll let you fill in the rest. But this is interesting because this is truly the last D model Mustang that was ever built. It's the last one off the line in Dallas, and it disappears during Korea. It does not come back. And you can tell this airplane, which was made for a war that's years and years in the past, is being essentially abused and used up during Korea. They're using it to haul bombs and napalm, and you can see the airfield is not as well prepared as it would be for a beautiful jet airplane. Okay, so now we're here. The B-21, which is the airplane at the top, this is an artist's view of it, a North American product of a bomber, a twin-engine bomber, and we were sort of working our way to the B-25. This airplane was one of the airplanes offered to the Army Air Forces at the time, and one of the competing designs was that B-18 we were talking about from Douglas. Douglas could make the airplane super cheap because they geared up to make DC-3s before the war. So what we see is even though the B-21 is a better airplane, it costs about $124,000 per unit. At the same time, Douglas's B-18 costs $64,000 per unit. So the Army decided to go with the Douglas design because they'd like to save money or get twice as many airplanes. So we get to the NA-40 that Kevin was talking about earlier. This is that hideous monster down below. It actually ran into many troubles and crash-landed at Wright-Patterson or Patterson Air Force Base or Airfield at the time where they were testing the airplane. And that was probably a good thing. It got kicked back to the factory. They started to make another airplane, NE-62, which becomes the B-25. This is a cool picture. This is Proud Papa's. The airplane's going to McCord Field up near Tacoma, and these are the first Army pilots getting their first B-25 in service. Of course, the B-25 is famous for the 16 that flew off of the aircraft carrier in April of 1942 as part of the Doolittle raid. Jimmy Doolittle actually came and visited the factory in Inglewood after the fact, and this is him addressing the crowds at North America. And one of the things he said that was really cool was when the press asked where the airplanes came from, they didn't want to know. They didn't want the press or the public at large to know they had the capability of launching these B-25s from an aircraft carrier. So he said they came from Shangri-La, which was just his hacky way of saying, we're not telling you where they came from. But when he came to the factory in Inglewood, what he said was, he went over the story and he said, I told them they came from Shangri-La, and this is where Shangri-La is. You guys are making these airplanes, and they're beautiful, and we want them to keep coming. There's also a pretty good change in what the B-25 is used for during the war. Of course, it's equipped with this Norden bomb sight. It's a medium bomber. The vibe early on in the war is we're going to fly these things over on their own or in groups and drop that bomb in a pickle barrel from 6, 8, 10,000 feet. Towards the end of the war, or the last years of the war, these airplanes are being used more as attack airplanes, specifically in China, or almost in China and in the Pacific. They're being loaded down with guns, and North American is actually responding by making different versions of the airplane that have weaponry out the front. This airplane's actually hitting a little destroyer escort, Japanese destroyer escort. And you can see his glass nose has been modified to carry 850 caliber machine guns. Some of the airplanes North American actually made with a 75 millimeter cannon in the nose. That's like a Sherman tank gun in the nose of the airplane, which is crazy. So back to Volpe in Downey, California. At the beginning of the war, they're making Vengeance bombers. A lot of them are going to Europe, and a lot of them are a little bit old and not really suitable for combat. They switch over and they start making things for Consolidated as well. This is one of my girlfriend's favorite pictures. This is, of course, supposed to be the typical lady working on the factory line, and she's a supermodel, and that pin curl hair do took hours to put together. But the Office of War Information would go around and shoot these pictures, and these are one of the pictures that reside in the archives in Washington, D.C., and it kind of gives us a good glimpse of an atypical worker at Volpe. This is a great picture, too, and it's very, very interesting. Notice the little guy in the picture, which is crazy. And I had one of my friends looking at this, and he's turning it over in his mind, and he said, well, how tall is the lady? And I was like, well, she's not like 14 feet tall. It's got to be a little guy. So little people were not drafted into the Army. And so this would get an illustration of a person that's not qualified to be in the military. And believe it or not, airplane companies love to have smaller people work for them, whether it be a 12-year-old boy or this guy. They would actually go around to circuses and draft people. And one of the reasons was that they could get into really, really super small areas that other people couldn't. They could crawl into the wing of the B-24 and work inside of it. So as crazy as it is, the airplane companies were super practical. If you're a deaf guy, work in the part of the factory where the hammers are blasting away all day long. If you're a blind person, that's fine. We're going to give you a box of intricate, weird pieces of mechanical pieces and have you put them together by feel and provide them to it. Anything and everything was a go at the factory. They made you work. Another thing that's sort of shocking, particularly when the war wasn't going very well, we're talking about 3 shifts a day, every day. You would come to work every day. California law says women got Sunday off. Men went every day. If you were a high school kid, a lot of the California schools were going 4 days a week, half time, and the other half day you worked at the factory. On Saturday, you also worked at the factory. So this was a big deal. In fact, it was a big deal towards the beginning of 1944 when things started to sort of relax. But this was this was people's lives for many, many years. Okay, so we have some of these outliers. This is Howard Hughes. One of the things that this is his H-1 racing airplane. One of the big myths was that the Japanese stole this design to make the Zero, which is pretty much debunked, but it's interesting to think about what Americans thought of Japanese designs at the time. Howard Hughes was somewhat involved in the war effort. He was not as cooperative as some people, believe it or not. And his designs were not ready for the end of the war, his entire aircraft design. But at the same time, Hughes Company employed a lot of people in the Hollywood and Culver City area, and they were used to make pieces of airplanes. Again, North American doesn't make every piece and part of an airplane. For example, the feed chutes that are in the wings of a Mustang are from Hughes. The motors that run those belts of 50 caliber machine gun bullets, the Mustang had a situation where if it was in a hard turn, as you might be in a dogfight, sometimes the weight of the belts would actually pull the bullets out of the gun, jam the gun, essentially. So what they made is these drive motors, and Hughes is the one that made them, to be able to feed those bullets into the gun, even if you're pulling 3 G's in a turn, attacking a Messerschmitt. So Hughes was kind of important to the area as a subcontractor. Of course, we know about these two projects, the XF-11. This is a reconnaissance airplane. It actually flew after the war, and Hughes was the one that flew it, and it crashed in Beverly Hills, almost killed him. And, of course, the Spruce Goose, the HK-1, this airplane that was made by Hughes and Kaiser to be able to fly across the Atlantic and transport materials. Okay, getting toward the end, I promise. This is Northrop in Hawthorne, California. And if we look at the output of Northrop, it's quite small. We're talking about 1,076 airplanes. And 706 of them were this, depending on who you are, if it's a beauty or not a beauty. And you can see Los Angeles in the background of this picture. This is a P-61 Black Widow. It's the first airplane that was made specifically as a night fighter. It has 20mm cannons in the belly and 50 calibers up on top. And inside that weird kooky bulbous nose is a radar system. And they would fly around at night, sometimes with success and sometimes without, looking for bad guys. This is a picture of Midnight Mickey in the Pacific. This is a run-up before takeoff. The airplane carried 3 people and sometimes a dog. Interestingly enough, a lot of the P-61 flyers I've talked to, it flew with a dog. I don't know why. It just seems like the thing. And these guys on Iwo Jima were saying that nothing fazed the dog. You could fire the 50 calibers, you could fly at night, didn't matter. So as soon as you started shooting those 20mm, the dog freaked out. Now why they had a dog, I don't know. There's probably some general somewhere who's probably kind of upset with that story. Okay, 2 more slides, maybe 3. Ryan, down in San Diego, we're coming full circle. Almost made entirely training airplanes. These are PT-20s, but they made a lot of PT-16s, PT-22s. So a lot of people that started their flying career started with Ryan airplanes. They ended with North American airplanes like the SMJ before they went on to other aircraft. Towards the end of the war, they actually started making fighter airplanes. This is a Ryan Fireball. And the crazy thing about this airplane is it has a propeller, piston engine, and it also has a jet. So I guess one of the cool things to do in California was to turn the piston engine off, feather the propeller like this, and cruise by some California flyer who was flying a Mustang or P-47 and just sort of, ease off in the distance and couldn't figure out exactly how this airplane was flying. The other thing that's interesting about the Ryan Fireball, of course there's one in the collection here, I always think, could there be a worse name for an airplane? Like, you want something that's intimidating, but not like what happens if you screw up, sort of thing. And maybe coming full circle, this of course is a Ryan airplane. It's an observation airplane. I'm going to go through my notes and make sure I get it right. It's a YO-51 that's being, YO-51 Dragonfly, a liaison plane that's taking off from Lindbergh Field, and that consolidated plant in the background is looking quite a bit larger at the time. And this is a good place to stop. Thank you very much. I have have copies of my book, limited amounts of copies. I'll certainly sign after the presentation and sell you guys books if you're interested in having these pictures and more. Thank you for your time.
Down to Boeing Family Day at Long Beach for the C-17 plan, and after seeing Corey's wonderful celebration of California's aerospace industry, I looked at the C-17 on the ramp. The Air Force orders were already filled. I think Australia and Great Britain were already filled. This was one last one on the ramp for the Indian Air Force, and they said, yeah, you can go look at it and walk around and whatnot. I looked at Ed Maloney. I said, you know, so you're looking at probably the last airplane ever built in California. And it was kind of tough for him, you know, because he grew up as a kid out here in the Inland Empire with all these different factories that Corey just outlined here. He got to visit them all. You know, Inglewood and Burbank and Santa Monica and Long Beach, all of them, and now just nothing. I mean, it just shows how times have changed, you know. I suppose part of it is demand and part of it is politics. Leave that up to you to decide that. But in any case, our next guest speaker, excuse me, let me get my notes here, sir, trained in the PBJ, which was the Navy and Marine Corps designation for the B-25. PBJ was, J was the designation for North American in the Navy and Marine Corps, and PB was like the patrol bomber. PBJ is in North Carolina, 1943 to 1944. Flew PBJs in the South Pacific at age 19. Served in Admiralty Islands near Australia, South Pacific. Please welcome Captain John Regal, United States Marine Corps retired. What we thought about doing was doing a kind of question and answer thing between me and Mr. Regler, but I think what we're going to do is I think we're just going to open up and let him start talking.
Good morning, veterans and supporters. Yes, you are very lucky because I didn't have a chance to prepare any speech. All I can do is kind of ramble, and Kevin told me to go ahead and tell stories of whatever I can remember. Surprising how much you can remember that made such an impact on your life at 17 and 19. It was quite a serious time in our country, and so many people pitched in and did their part to keep it going. So we support the home folks as well as the 16 million who were in the armed forces. I do have a lot to remember, and I hope I don't spend too much time just thinking of some of the little things. Some were major, some you think were high, but others were just little things day to day that hard to forget. You just think back. I guess I'll be getting in the beginning, and
cut me off. We got time.
The main, the beginning for me was after Pearl Harbor. We knew what was going on in the world, and it was wartime, and time would come when we'd probably be into it. I was interested that I was a skinny senior in high school when Pearl Harbor occurred, and lived on a farm, so wasn't much I could do except wait. And graduated in June, still 17, and waiting for the draft. One day, bunch of us were attending a bond rally out in the athletic field. There were kind of some bonds and stamps and recruiting and so on. So walking around, I came to a Navy recruiter. Officer in his white uniform, aggressive. So walking by, he said, "Hey, want to come mock up?" Which they had there. "Oh, sure, anything for an invasion." So I got in it and strapped in, was elevated. Pretty soon they turned it on and started roaming around our and got me out, and I didn't have any problem with it. Walked away. He said, "Hey, how'd you like to join the aviation cadet program?" "Oh, I sure work better than the ground." So, I can sign you up. But in the B-5 program, but you have to wait until you're 18 to swear in, and your parents have to sign for you. So, told him where I live, he came out, signed me up, and said, "Okay, we'll call you when you're 18. And they did. Went up to Detroit, swore in, and said, "Well, now you got to wait for someplace to go." And so we waited. I went to a semester of college to fill in. And sure enough, in March, I received the notice to report to Detroit and prepare to travel. So, on March 8th, there were about a dozen of us from 19-year-olds who, from Michigan, Ohio, who came to stay at that office. You know, that's one of the details. How do you remember what hotel you stayed at in 1943? I don't know. But I did it at the Cadillac Hotel, right? He was in Detroit, right? So we stayed overnight, got on the plane, and the train in the morning, and headed west. We ended up in Helena, Montana. Boy, out of the farm, we've never been out of Michigan, Ohio. Goes out to the Wild West. And it was, at that time, still pretty wild. Gold mining town in a bucket of blood balloon, a saloon, mining, and shoot 'em up. So anyway, it was quite an experience. It was fun, and we stayed at a boys' Catholic school. There weren't any boys around, they were all in the service. So they put us up, I think it was a way of subsisting until they could get students again. To wonderful school now, by the way. We got to wear uniforms from the Depression. The green wool and everything was what they wore in the CCC. That was our uniform. Things were desperate. We learned some things about engines and their aircraft and navigation and signaling. We got to fly Piper Cubs out at the airport. And that was our first experience in flying and trained. It was pretty good country to train in. It was pretty wide open, some hills. Excuse me. But it's a good experience. And a good time. We had a pretty good time. We had to stay an extra month because they didn't have room for us anywhere. I think we were the second class of B-5 cadets at Carroll. And I think we're the last ones. I don't know what happened in the pipeline by then for pilots, but I think it was starting to fade out. And I'll probably pause for my time, okay, if you forgive me. The mind doesn't always work as well as I might. The next class came in was B-12, which we should for it. So we finally got clearance to go to St. Mary's College in California. This is mostly physical, mental, and learning about the Navy. The Navy was our trainers. And so that was pretty good duty. We got new uniforms for finally. And we had weekends in San Francisco or Berkeley. I know I'm random, but you know this is how my darn mind works. I'm going through memories. They were real memories to me. And they still have an impact on me. And thank God to lead me all the way. And we had some good times. They treated us like officers in San Francisco. And I guess because we have blue uniform and had a star on our sleeve. But anyway, the dances, you know, those people there for us to dance with and so on. And the next was Pasco, Washington. Went there for primary flight training, went We went into the great plane I love, is the Stearman. The Yellow Peril, they were yellow in the Navy. And as far as I'm concerned, they were the most fun to fly. We did aerobatics, formations, low level flight, It was just a sport plane. We have one in here, and they're still around, and still people. I've had two flights here. On flight day, they take a passenger. I've got two times in the Stearman, and you can't ask for more than that. Appreciate that. Anyway, I've appreciated the Planes of Fame for many years. I think, 20 or more? It's been some great times going back to some people that have been here. Patty Boynton has been here, and Engine Jay from Squadron 8, and just a whole bunch. The whole history is a lovable place. Appreciate Ed and everybody, Kevin, and volunteers for putting it on board. So, where was I? I was in Pottsville, Washington, flying Stearman, and that was about 3 months. We had a good night at Pascal, enjoyed that, and went on then to Corpus Christi, California, Texas, and the main base for training, and spent time in the bot. Trained in that, and then we had to choose between what we wanted to serve in. And a bunch of us said, let's put down, we listen to fighters. Put down all the engine. Okay. And also, you got to choose which service you're going to be in, Navy or Marines. Duplication. And so someone said, hey, I hear we can fly the A-20. Let's put down the mother engine. We did. We started out there. We got what we asked for. And we started training in SNBs, which is a Beechcraft twin engine, small, about 4 or 5 passengers. But anyway, it was good practice landing and navigation. We've done a lot of navigation, including celestial, and we were going to be over water, we figured, so we had to learn how to figure the waves ball. Anyway, I completed that base until June of 44, which I was then got a commission in the Marine Corps in my wings, and took time home through some rehab, and then to Eden, North Carolina, where we exposed to the B-25, or as we call them, PBJ, and got to stay there until, until December, January. Got married when I was there. That's a big event. Thanks. And so I went out to the West Coast, San Diego, Miramar, and waiting. There's a lot of waiting. I figured I could have been out in the field by a year earlier, but wouldn't have been time between bases and just waiting. But anyway, we're going to get a ship ride to the Pacific, and we know that VE Day happened on the day before we were going, and we got to celebrate on it. Yeah, like a nothing. All that was going on back in San Diego, and we were confined in the ship. So, anyway, we left next step in the morning on a victory ship, zigzag, and to Pearl Harbor, and then we headed up near Admiralty Islands in South Pacific, and they picked us up and took us to an island called Emeru, which is in those islands. And we joined the MAG Japanese base, Navy base at Rabaul, the Noir, and the South, and the, yeah.
The island was what? I get it.
And the island, the base at Rabaul was a main feeding place for Guadalcanal, and the whole area of the Pacific was the main base. And it was part of the strategy to heading for Australia, but the Japanese pretty much controlled the Pacific, and so they had their sights on us to get some attack. And so we were not the only one. The Fifth Air Force, Navy, Australia, we had pilots at our base from Australia, flying Corsairs. And that continued. It was a delaying action because they didn't want to spend the bodies on an invasion. They could have. Sure, the Japanese were waiting one for one and prepared. They had 100,000 troops there and many caves and tunnels and planes and storage, so that our bombing didn't affect that. We mainly got the airstrip clear and the bay from shipping. They were isolated, couldn't get out. And but there were a lot of different Army, Navy, 24s. Doing the job. About July, we were loaded up and flew up to the Philippines to prepare for the invasion. We had been training, wing rockets, low level, and tiny tin rockets and bomb bags. So we started preparing there. Went up to Mindanao, had a base there, and continued to get ready. About that time, the atomic bombs went down. And of course, we were all excited about that. And so, as we know, the Japanese surrendered, celebrated that, made an invasion behind it. It would certainly be been terrible in the loss of life for both us and Japanese people. Because they, we learned in Okinawa, they tend to fight for the death. They don't surrender. So that week, we celebrated again on a base instead of at home where everybody else was having fun. We're in destiny. Now the guys are pretty good. Turned over a couple of jeeps. But it was pretty good. Let's see. You know, there was a story. Remember the bird incident that landed in the Hudson River because of birds? Well, I had a bird fly me. While in the Philippines, we were north a ways and on our way back. I don't remember all the details, but I was flying both on the right side. And it was getting dark, so we had to fly over some very high areas. And I turned around to check the gas back forward. Just as I turned, a whap. I got a whap in my face. And I guess it knocked me out. Something that we found out that the huge bird. He landed on my side. I didn't believe the pilot were picking that. But he landed on my side. And landed right where that cross brace is. And into the plexiglass. And covered me. Whatever. I still can't believe how that pilot threw that plane back to base with that 200 mile an hour wind coming in that side. It's a miracle. But I am glad that the bird didn't go into the engine or so. That could have been worse. But anyway, I got down and took me into the medic and took me out and examined me and everything. He said, "That blood in you is the bird's blood." I was hardly touched They had to carry me out there. I don't even know what happened. But, so, in your shower, where are you going? All those things like that. And then another time, I had a tire blow out on takeoff. Just going down the runway, and got off, and pow, brand new U.S. Royal tire run. And nothing happened to the plane. Got the wing and your prop. To us, we got, went into medical and nothing wrong, but we were entitled to a shot of Minnesota brand. So there are things like that. It's things that you think of, and was glad that it was over, glad we won the war. It was a terrific effort. We had the Lord with us, I know. So, Kevin, that's all. I have to run out.
Time, what we can do is we can take a little questions and answers. We've got a few minutes. If you'd like, anybody like to field some questions to our two panelists up here, what we'll do is we'll see if we can get a microphone. If you want to stand up, and we'll get the mic over to you, you'll be next.